Will the health care law in the United States diminish the full-time workforce? A new congressional report believes it could. House Budget Committee member Congressman Sean Duffy will explain. And the Winter Olympics are underway in Sochi, Russia. Three-time Olympic gymnast Dominique Dawes is here to tell us about her Olympic experience and opine on these games. And later, the UN is calling out the Vatican's handling of the global sex abuse crisis, as well as church doctrine. Robert Royal and Austin Ruse will react. And finally, the Messiah returns to the big screen later this month in Son of God. We'll bring you an exclusive sneak peek with producers Mark Burnett and Roma Downey. The World Over Live begins right now.
Now, from Washington, D.C., Raymond Arroyo.
A warm welcome to all of you joining us in the United States and the world over. How are we going to get all of this into one show? Congressman Sean Duffy, Dominique Dawes, Robert Royal, Austin Ruse, as well as Mark Burnett and Roma Downey are straight ahead. If you'd like to comment on tonight's program, send us a tweet at Raymond Arroyo, and I'll be live tweeting throughout the show. Or drop us an email, worldover@EWTN.com. Lots to get to. Let's get to it. Here's the brief news from the world over this week. Same-sex marriage is now legal in Scotland. Despite strong opposition from both the Catholic Church and organizations, Parliament overwhelmingly approved the historic measure on Tuesday. Under the bill, religious entities that perform or wish to perform gay marriages can opt in to do so. However, opponents of the law say churches and others are not protected from litigation should they refuse to bless a same-sex union. Several religious protection amendments were rejected, including one forbidding compulsory church ceremonies. Scotland is the 17th country to open the door to same-sex marriage. And in a related story, Scotland's only Catholic adoption agency this week won its appeal to continue being recognized as a charity. Last year, the Scottish government moved to strip St. Margaret's Children and Family Care Society of its charity status, after it was found to be breaking the Equality Act of 2010, because the agency does not place children with same-sex couples. After St. Margaret's won its appeal, a government official told the Herald of Scotland that it was not in anyone's interest to close an organization that provides such a valuable service to vulnerable children. And Buckingham Palace has announced that Queen Elizabeth II will soon visit Rome and Pope Francis. She and her husband, Prince Philip, will have an audience with the Pope on April 3rd. According to the BBC, the visit will be relaxed and take place in the Pope's residence. This will be the Queen's fourth visit to the Vatican. She's previously met with Pope John XXIII in 1960 and twice with Pope John Paul II. More recently, the Queen received Pope Benedict XVI during his 2009 historic visit to the UK. Her Majesty is, of course, the head of the Anglican Church. And the abortion debate is heating up in Spain as Prime Minister Mariano Rajoy looks to limit the country's abortion laws. On Saturday, thousands of pro-choice advocates took to the streets of Madrid to protest Parliament. The legislative body is considering the reversal of a 2010 law allowing abortion on demand up to 14 weeks of pregnancy. Approved by Rajoy's cabinet in December, the proposed law would ban all abortions save for cases of rape or if the mother's health is in serious risk. The Catholic Church is also the target of protests over the measure. On Sunday, topless members of the notorious feminist group Femen swarmed the Cardinal Archbishop of Madrid outside a church before Mass. They threw women's undergarments at him while shouting, "Abortion is sacred." Meanwhile, there is some good news trending in the United States as the abortion rate reached its lowest level since abortion was made legal in 1973. According to the Guttmacher Institute's latest national survey, the number of abortions fell by 13% between 2008 and 2011. That said, there are still over 1 million abortions performed annually. And New York's new mayor is drawing criticism after announcing he will not be marching in this year's St. Patrick's Day parade. Bill de Blasio said he's boycotting one of the city's signature celebrations because of its ban on gay signs. The ban has been in place since the 1990s. Previously, parade organizers have said the event is simply a celebration of the city's strong Irish heritage and that gays are welcome to march in the parade so long as they do not carry identifying signs or banners. Catholic League President Bill Donahue is mincing no words over the de Blasio boycott. Donahue, who is an annual parade participant, says he's delighted, noting that he wouldn't want to march with a public official who, quote, does not want to be associated with Irish Catholics, end quote. And former Papal Secretary Cardinal Stanislaw Zivic is taking some heat for his decision to publish the personal notes and reflections of his former boss, Blessed Pope John Paul II. The compilation, titled I Am Very Much in God's Hands, was released this week in Poland. In his will, the late Pope asked that the notes be destroyed after his death. Now, Cardinal Zivic said recently that he did not have the courage to destroy the notes and had no doubt about publishing them. He said the notes tell so much about the spiritual side of the great Pope that it would have been a crime to destroy them. More about this later in the show with Robert Royal and Austin Ruse. And finally, Pope Francis's Harley Davidson is hitting the road. The motorcycle was the hot ticket item at the Paris auction on Thursday. An unidentified European agreed to pay $327,000 for the hog. It was a gift to the Holy Father last year from Willie Davidson, the retired Harley Davidson designer and grandson of the company's co-founder. It is not known if Pope Francis ever rode the 2013 Dyna Super Glide, but he did sign it. A Harley Davidson leather jacket, also signed by Pope Francis, fetched $78,000. Proceeds from the sales will be donated to a soup kitchen and hostel for the homeless in Rome. That's called poping your ride. When we return, how will the Affordable Care Act affect employment in the U.S.? Congressman Sean Duffy will unpack the numbers released this week by the Congressional Budget Office, and Dominique Dawes, Roma Downey, and Mark Burnett are coming up when the World Over Live continues. Stay right there.
Once again, Raymond Arroyo.
Welcome back to the World Over Live. The Affordable Care Act is the law of the land. There was a disastrous website rollout, the policy cancellations, and now a new report from the Congressional Budget Office. The nonpartisan office says the health care law will suppress full-time employment in the coming years. Here to make sense of the CBO report, as well as the current state of immigration reform and the debt limit, is a member of the House Budget Committee, Congressman Sean Duffy of Wisconsin's 7th District, whom I spoke with earlier in studio. Let's talk initially about this CBO report. This is a Congressional Budget Office report, the nonpartisan Congressional Budget Office, and they looked at the health care bill, the Obamacare bill, and what they determined is that 2.3 million jobs will disappear, full-time jobs, by 2021. They're saying this is due to the effects of Obamacare. How do you interpret this?
Well, first of all, this is something that we anticipated. A lot of the consequences of this new health care reform package have come to pass, the things that we have claimed. But first of all, in regard to job creation, or the lack thereof, that we're going to lose 2.3 million jobs.
Full-time jobs.
Full-time jobs. Remember the promise that Ms. Pelosi made? She said this bill would actually create 4 million new jobs. The truth is it's going to cost minimally 1.5 million jobs. Mm-hmm. And the bottom line is if you're a hard-working middle-class American or even in poverty, what you're looking for is more opportunity. You're looking for more education, more upward mobility. And this legislation isn't going to incentivize harder work and more opportunity. It's killing the American dream for so many more people in the country.
Now, I've spoken to a number of people across the aisle from you in the Congress, and they're telling me What you're not saying about the CBO report, what Paul Ryan isn't reporting, is the premiums are lower, and this ends what they call job lock, where people have to stay in a given job. And I want to play a bite for it for you. This is Jason Furman. He's the chair of the Council on Economic Advisors, or of Economic Advisors, rather. Here's his explanation for why these numbers come down the way they do.
What CBO found, and this is their summary quote near the top of Appendix C, again, quote, the estimated reduction, this is the reduction in the total quantity of labor that all of you have seen and talked about. Quote, the estimated reduction stems almost entirely from a net decline in the amount of labor that workers choose to supply, rather than from a net drop in businesses' demand for labor. What's relevant about that is their word itself is choose. This is a choice on the part of workers.
That's a rather strange explanation, but your take on that?
Listen, you can spin this however you want. The bottom line is you have 2.3 million less jobs in America. And if you don't have people who are out there working hard, going for that American dream, our country isn't better off for it. And I think the administration finds itself in a very tough spot. These numbers are not good for them, and they have to get creative to spin it in a way that's going to make it look in the best light.
So is this an incentive not to work because of the way this bill is written?
Well, listen. If you don't have a lot of money, you get good benefits through Obamacare. And sometimes if you go back to work and you start climbing that economic ladder, you're disincentivized because you start to lose some of the benefits in Obamacare. Mm-hmm. And listen, I'm all about making sure we help people who are falling on hard times, people who find themselves in a difficult spot. But if we're incentivizing them not to get engaged in the workforce, that doesn't breed happiness, that doesn't breed prosperity, and I think it can create a real rot within our culture.
Let's talk about immigration reform. Yeah. This has become a hot topic since your retreat last week. Yeah. I understand things were a bit contentious in the retreat.
They were a bit contentious, Raymond. Listen, people come at this with a lot of passion and a lot of heart and a lot of different ideas, and sometimes it relates back to the part of the country that you're from. Mm-hmm. I believe there's a space for us to do immigration reform because right now the system's broken. Mm-hmm. It's not working right now. You see people coming in across the border without documentation. Mm-hmm. And if we don't do it now, as conservatives, you have 11 million people today. 20 years, you'll have 15 or 25 million mm-hmm. people. So I think we have to address it. And if you put on your conservative lens like I do, what I think you do is you have to secure the border. Now, we have to agree, what does that look like? How do you verify it? But you secure the border so the problem ceases. And then you have a work visa system that works, meaning the demands of our economy can bring in high-skill and low-skill labor legally to meet the demands of our economy. But I think the big thing, the 11 million people who are here, I think that if you offer them legal status, and we gotta be clear on this, some go, that's amnesty. No,
and you're granting, and the idea would be to extend legal status and possible citizenship to the children who are brought here, the so-called dreamers.
There's a conversation about giving a pathway to citizenship for the dreamers, the kids. The kid that came here at 2 years old mm-hmm. doesn't know Mexico or the country of origin. Mm-hmm. But what's more important is what's happening with those who are here without documentation. If you give them legal status, that's not making them a citizen, meaning they can't collect off the entitlement system and they can't vote, but they can stay here legally. Mm-hmm. If they want to travel and go see their parents back in their home country who they haven't seen for 18 years, they can travel. They're not going to get arrested in the middle of the night. If you do that, there would be no pathway to citizenship that's created for them.
But here's the question that people raise, and they say, okay, that's very nice. And whether it's Newt Gingrich during the last election saying, do you want to remove that 75-year-old grandmother and throw her out, send her back to this country she doesn't know anymore, or do you remove this child? In either case, you can't have this individual, in this case a young person, here alone. The family has to be here with them. The bishops have stressed family unity. So aren't you really saying you got to keep the whole family here? We're going to make some pathway for the entire family.
Listen, I think we have to be sensitive to the families that are here. And I think you're right. And we want to keep them together. And I think this is a way to do it that treats everybody fairly. And it's solving the problem. And again, making sure that those parents who are here without documentation can stay, but and if they want to become citizens, I want to be clear on this, mm-hmm. no special pathway, but you can apply like anybody else. You're not prohibited from applying. And I think, I look at the kids. I've got six kids, Raymond, and some people will argue we don't want to educate kids in our K through 12 schools. Listen, they're still kids. We don't want a whole subclass of people who aren't educated in our country. I think we have to be compassionate on how we deal with this problem. People who are here, most people who came to work in this country, not to suck off the entitlement system, and to do it fairly and compassionately and fix the problem, I think is the best pathway forward.
Mitch McConnell on the Senate side says no chance this year. He's not bringing it forward. It's not going to come up.
Listen, this is going to be tough to get it done this year.
Mm-hmm. Because it's an election year.
Well, yeah, but that doesn't mean we shouldn't be working on it. Mm-hmm. And working on a solution that could happen next year, I think is real positive. Listen, I don't think you're going to get a Republican to vote for this. Mm-hmm. But I think there's some Democrats who want immigration reform because they want extra votes. They're doing it for political reasons. Mm-hmm. But I think more of them, they like us, they care about people. They want to do the right thing by people in their community, do the right thing by kids in their community. And I think we can find a bipartisan approach to be fair and compassionate.
Mm-hmm. When we return, what does it take to win Olympic gold? Iconic Olympian gymnast Dominique Dawes is here to talk about her road to Olympic glory, the games in Sochi, and the faith and family that sustains her today. The World Over Live continues in a moment.
Now, once again, Raymond Arroyo.
Welcome back to the World Over Live. My next guest is a three-time Olympic gymnast. She's won four medals, including the gold, between team and individual competition. And she is the first African-American woman to win the individual medal in gymnastics when she took home the bronze in 1996 for her floor exercises in Atlanta. Here to talk about her road to the Olympics, the sacrifice it took to get there, and what she's doing now, as well as her take on the Sochi Games, I'm pleased to be joined by a member of the Magnificent Seven, awesome Dawesome herself, Dominique Dawes. So great to have you here.
Thank you for having me.
And you're about to be a mom soon.
I am, only a few weeks away.
Well, thanks for coming. We're going to talk about this experience, okay, too, which I'm sure has changed you in ways you never imagined.
Yes, very exciting.
Psychologically, otherwise.
Yes,
so we'll get into all of that. Take me back to how this journey started. I read somewhere you said this was really the hand of God, because your parents, who were right over here in Maryland, they went to sign you up for something other than gymnastics. What happened?
Well, my mom signed my sister and I up for a tumbling lesson, and no one signed up. We didn't know that, of course, at first. No one signed up, so they canceled that class, and then my mom found a gymnastics gym that was right across the street from a mall that she used to frequent, and I fell in love when I first stepped into the gymnastics gym at 6 years old.
Oh my gosh, and that's how it all began, at 6 years old. Tell me about Karen Hill, who is your coach for 18 years.
Yes, it was Kelly Hill.
Kelly Hill.
And she's not only been a coach, but very much like a mother figure to me. She's been someone that not only taught me how to dream, but she taught me how to accomplish and do things in life and to believe in myself, to embrace my differences, and to always set higher heights than I could ever imagine for myself.
How did she prepare you for the work you're doing now, which is really inspiring young people, helping them down the road to nutrition and wellness and mm-hmm. fitness? How did she shape that little girl into who you've become?
She shaped me by kicking my butt every single day.
Tough love.
It was definitely tough love. Every single day we had practice, there were goals that we had to accomplish. There were high expectations. There was a little bit of pressure every now and then. But, you know, she saw that I could achieve here where I could only see here. And she made me believe in myself. And I think that's what has instilled a great deal of passion, a great deal of purpose, and a great deal of perseverance in me.
When we see images of Dominique Dawes on the floor, as we do here, this is from 1996, there doesn't seem to be any inhibitions, nervousness, the calm, the poise of this young woman, young girl. Where did that come from? And you say that at that time you were battling self-doubt.
Mm-hmm.
and it's security.
Well, I have told many people that I faked it pretty well. You know, you fake it till you make it. And in my mind, though, I was doubting myself. I didn't always believe that I was good enough, and I many times was more of a pessimist at times. I went out there and at least went for it. And I had the support of my coach. I had certain family members that supported me. My teammates were always behind me, and the fans kept me loving the sport of gymnastics. But inside, I was a nervous ninny, though on the outside, I showed a cool, calm, and collected individual.
No, when you see an athlete before they begin, mm-hmm. there is that, and you see it, when you take to the floor, you breathe in, and it's that, that moment of calm. Mm-hmm. Are you visualizing in that moment what you're about to do? What's happening in that moment?
You know, I think visualization has not worked well for me. Wow. I tend to be that person that does not always visualize the outcome that I truly do desire. Uh-huh. So it wasn't about visualization with me. It was calming myself, getting at peace, affirmations. I created a personal motto when I was a young child. I called it D3, determination, dedication, desire. Yeah. So I would repeat these affirmations and even scriptures like Philippians 4:13, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Yeah. And I would keep that on my mind so that whenever those moments of doubt or negativity would come in, I would try to push it out with these positive words.
You were ready. You were ready. Yeah. What was the worst part of this journey for you, looking back?
You know, I wouldn't say, and everyone assumes that I would say the failures that I made, the mistakes that I made at the Olympic Games in like 1996 when I fell in the all-around competition, when I was en route to get a medal and be on the podium. That was a tough moment, but it really did shape me as an athlete and as a person. It made me go home, look at myself in the mirror, and realize that the only one that I could have blamed for that mistake was myself. And so I went back to years ago or months ago before the Olympics, and I thought about how I didn't want to tumble or do that tumbling pass, or I had that negative thought that was creeping into my mind and I allowed fear to overtake me, and it came back and it bit me at the Olympics, and I made that mistake. And so that was a tough moment to overcome. It was a great life lesson, and I learned that if you give 60% effort, you're going to get 60% outcome. And that is something that Kelly, my coach, always spoke to us athletes about, but you don't get it until you experience it sometimes. And so though that was a tough moment, it was a life-changing moment that has helped me today, even as a 37-year-old businesswoman.
But isn't that, I mean, I watched that just the other day.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Isn't it really, just like Drew Brees not quite making that connection, isn't it just at a certain point, the circumstances, dumb luck at that moment? I mean, you've trained your whole life, you're fit, everything's perfect. Is it really your fault in that moment?
Oh, yes, it is. But you can always learn a lesson from it. I think I've learned more from my failures in life when I've fallen on my face, either in my athletic career or my personal life. I mean, I'm married now, so I constantly am failing with that. Like, oh, why did I do that? Or why did I say that? You know, so you're constantly learning life lessons if you choose to step away from the situation and recognize, how could I have handled that differently? How could I have prepared for that situation differently?
Now, you've said that you suffered also from this perfectionism where everything had to be perfect. Good enough wasn't good enough. Mm-mm. It had to be perfect. Is that a little of what I'm still hearing here?
Oh, yes. It's a little bit of what you're hearing, but the fact that I am now soon to be a mother, or I even consider myself a mother right now, I'm learning to let go and to let God. I'm learning to not focus on being a perfectionist, and I'm learning to just relax and not, you know, set these unrealistic at times expectations. And it's a struggle for me. This has been a very hard journey in my life, but something I've always desired. But you really do need to put pride and your ego aside and learn to accept sometimes, you know, good is sometimes good enough.
Yeah, and I mean, in this circumstance, being an athlete, someone who is so primed your body and focused on it and made sure it was just so, watched what you ate, worked out, you're literally transformed.
I am, and it's so not that now. It's very difficult.
Is it scary?
It's not. It's scary, yes, but it's something I've always desired. Mm-hmm. And I know that right now my child is very much in control, and I always have known that God is in control. So it's just me learning to let go and to embrace this experience and embrace the fact that I have a new and different body, embrace the emotional roller coasters that I've gone through as a pregnant woman, and to embrace what's going to happen when I become a new mom.
Well, so, you look fantastic, and I'm sure there's a lot of mothers out there going, I wish I looked like that when I was 8 months pregnant.
Oh, thank you.
You've said in interviews, and you often say, you know, if I'm blessed to have a child, I would not want that child to go into gymnastics.
I know.
Do you still stand by that statement?
You know, I've matured, and I love the sport of gymnastics, but I know how difficult it was, mm-hmm. but I felt as if I was called to be a gymnast. I'm very blessed, and I'm very thankful for the physical talent, the emotional, fortitude that I was blessed with, amazing coaches, amazing teammates. But for my little one, I didn't want to put her through that same journey. However, my husband and I went to a gymnastics meet, and I right away saw these itsy bitsy little leotards, and I was like, oh, I can't wait to put our child in a leotard. And my husband looks at me and is like, oh, okay. So, you know,
so you're revising your last statement.
So I think he's going to be on board with it, but I'm 5'3 and he's 6'3, so we might not get a gymnastics shaped
right.
child.
You need those tight
petite
bodies. Yeah, you can't have big, tall,
no.
Tall people doing this. Tell us about the sacrifice involved. We look in at the Olympics as people are beginning to do now, mm-hmm. and you see these athletes. Give me a sense of the daily sacrifice that you went through and what these athletes in Sochi are about to embrace.
Well, I'm sure these athletes in Sochi that committed just as much, maybe even more than myself and my Olympic teammates did. But mm-hmm. in the sport of gymnastics, you're very young. You peak as a teenager. So our mm-hmm. commitment was a little different than maybe some athletes. Yeah. I would wake up at 5 o'clock in the morning. I would train from 6 to 8 in the morning. I went to public school 8:20 to 2:30, and then back to the gymnastics gym 3 to 8 p.m. at night. And we trained 6 days a week. We got a couple of mornings off sometimes and 5 hours on the weekend. And it seems like it's a little much, yeah. but if you would have asked me if I wanted to be there, I did. I loved it. I had a passion for it. Mm-hmm. I had set dreams and goals. And it was the environment where I could truly flourish. I could be myself. And I reached my full potential there. So I wouldn't change it.
What was the secret of the Magnificent Seven, looking back, that particular team of young women? Mm-hmm.
Those girls were, I always say, they were the most talented girls I had ever competed against. They made me a better athlete, mm-hmm. and I've ever competed with. They not only had a strong work ethic, but mentally they were tough and they were strong. We were all type A personalities, which many people cannot tolerate. But we all were, you know, we were like cut from the same cloth. And I really think our secret was putting our egos aside. Our coaches put their egos aside, the USA Gymnastics Federation put their egos aside, and we did what was best for our country and what was best for our team. It wasn't about one individual taking a spotlight leading up to the competition. It was all about us supporting one another, and that's why we won.
Tell me about, you've been watching, no doubt, all this coverage about Sochi and the Winter Olympics. 57% of Americans in a new CNN poll say there will be a terrorist attack at the Olympics, and we've been hearing these terrorist organizations making the threats for months. Mm-hmm. Would you, as an athlete, or as a family member of an athlete, go to Sochi?
As an athlete, I would definitely go, and I don't think I've heard anything about an athlete backing out. Mm-hmm. As an athlete, you're always taught to focus on the things that you can control and don't focus on the things that you can't control. Mm-hmm. We had a similar situation in 1996 at the Olympic Games in Atlanta with the bombing there that unfortunately took the life of a mother. We had heard about threats leading up to those Olympic Games while we were there, even fan mail that wasn't so positive.
Really?
But the thing is you just learn to put that aside, and you're there to get a job done. You're there to be a good representative for your country. And remember, these athletes didn't start training last year. They've been training, many of them, their whole lives since they were children, and they're not going to walk away from
this.
What
did you do the day of a major competition? What was your schedule like, and how did you sort of put yourself in that zone?
You know, you usually don't break away from your normal routine. I mean, you're still going to train first thing in the morning for a number of hours. You go back, you have a good meal, you nap, you rest. You don't usually watch the news. They don't allow you to watch TV. They don't allow you to read newspapers of what reporters are saying about you, good or bad. Mm-hmm. You're removed from society. You don't connect usually with your family members because they will add a little bit of extra pressure.
Oh,
in some cases, some athletes probably do need to talk to mom or dad. But in my case, I just stayed in my own head, but focused on those positive affirmations.
But you didn't stay at the Olympic Village.
No, we didn't.
For your games. Why not?
Well, we stayed at the Olympic Village in 1992, which was awesome because we got to meet the Dream Team when they came for accreditations. But in 96, they didn't have us stay, mainly for security purposes, and also because at that time, our team was so popular, even before we won an Olympic gold medal. And so they had us stay at Emory University a distance away, and then same thing in Sydney at the 2000 Olympics. We stayed at an Australian girls' school.
Now, you are the co-chair of the President's Council on Fitness, Sports, and Nutrition.
Yes.
You've been traveling the country doing events on nutrition, talking to schools and young women. You mentor here in D.C. What is the primary mistake, do you think, that parents make vis-a-vis nutrition and fitness for their children?
You know, I've been speaking on the importance of these topics for quite a few years now, since after my 1996 win. And I always went into an event assuming that people had the knowledge, they had the education, they knew what healthy eating looked like, they knew what sports and fitness and physical activity looked like, they understood the amount that their child should get. And I think with the President's Council, which is why I love working with this group, is we've realized that people are not as knowledgeable as we thought they were. You know, of what's good nutrition for your kids? What's good physical activity for your kids? Why is sports participation so important? It's not just about winning and losing, but it's really about getting their mind and their body more active. And so I think the number one thing is educating parents on why it's so important, not only for today for their kids, but more importantly for their the longevity of their health as these young kids grow up to be adults someday.
The obesity rate is sky high. It is slowly decreasing, but it's marginal.
Yeah.
Why do you think that is? Is it because we have big gulps and we have such access to junk food so often?
I think it's a couple of things. I think number one, self-control. I think a lot of us, you know, we just assume that if we have a meal that's this big that we have to eat it all. And I remember as a kid, my grandfather saying to us young kids, you're not getting up until you finish all your food. Or my parents saying, you're not leaving this table until you finish all your food. And there was a lot of food on that plate. And that's great that we had this plentiful amount of food, and we do in the United States in some areas, not in all areas, but in some areas. But the thing is we need to start eating to live and not living to eat.
Yep.
And just think the many times we've gone to the movie theaters and we think, oh, I'm gonna get that medium popcorn, and you just keep eating and eating. And it's like a two and a half hour movie, and we don't really need to.
We get the barrel, you know.
And we're full. So listen to your body, listen to your mind.
And don't get the replenishing barrel of popcorn.
And don't, and I've done that, especially being pregnant, it's not good. And so I think a lot of it is self-control, and then I think a lot of it is we've always been taught that the unhealthy food does taste a lot better.
Yeah.
And so we go for those. My husband loves his chip parties.
Oh.
And so he always goes for those chip parties. And I'm like, moderation is key. I love fried food. I'm never going to not have French fries. I'm never going to not have a burger. But the thing is, make more smarter decisions than unhealthy decisions. So
before I let you go, you had a conversion to the Catholic Church.
I have.
Tell me about that. Where that came. You were raised Baptist.
Mm-hmm.
But there was a connection in the family to
there
the Catholic
was.
Church. Tell me about
yes,
that.
Yes, my grandmother, my father's mother, Lillian Catherine, and she is no longer here today, but she was Catholic, and she was also from Southern Maryland and part of the Piscataway Kanoi Native American tribe.
Wow.
And when I was younger, I was raised Baptist. When I became a young adult, I went toward the interdenominational faith, which it was fulfilling for me for a while. Mm-hmm. And then I just felt a calling to go into the Catholic Church about 7 years ago. I stepped in, enjoyed Mass, felt a lot of peace, a lot of silence, more of a connection with God there, but didn't quite find the connections with the people to get a better understanding of what the Catholic faith was all about. And so a few years ago when I met my husband, we were just dating at the time, he's Catholic, and he introduced me to the faith, not pressuring me whatsoever.
Kind of explain
a little bit more about what's happening.
It takes time.
Yeah, and it's all about healing. And I've always been in need of healing, believe it or not. And you know, the things I struggled with as a children with self-esteem and doubt and all of that, I just felt a little bit more fulfilled in the Catholic faith with that. And so I tell them all the time, I enjoy and look forward to going to confession. I think it really does release a lot from my soul. We have a wonderful priest, Father Dan, that's been assisting us both in together and even individually. Another priest, Father Mike, locally, has been, you know, a breath of fresh air for me. And so, you know, I just know this is where God has always wanted me to be, and it's just taken a while to get
there. Now, obviously, you're embracing a major vocation now with motherhood.
Oh, yes.
But tell me about the other vocation you discovered after your gymnastic career.
You know, my other vocation was motivational speaking. I am by nature an introvert. And
what?
Oh, yes.
Come on.
Oh, yes.
You're about as introverted as I am, but
I like people, but I'm someone that I love being home. It maybe you know, with my husband and a few other people, but I'm not someone that is comfortable right away going and speaking in front of big crowds. And it's taken me a while to get comfortable, but I have this passion, and I truly feel as if this is my purpose, to help inspire young people to believe in themselves. Just what my coach did for me, though, you know, with a lot of tough love, I do it in a different manner. I do it in a different way than Kelly did for me. I don't do it in the coaching world, but just helping kids realize that they have this beautiful gift inside of themselves, that they have a purpose, that they can find their passion. And I try to instill that in young kids through a number of the different talks that I've done.
Well, you're fantastic. Thank you so much for coming on. Will you come back?
I would love to come back.
We'll do it.
Nice
great to see you, Dominique.
Thank you.
Thank you. You can learn more about Dominique and follow her media appearances and speaking engagements by visiting her website at DominiqueDawes.com, DominiqueDawes.com. When we return, Robert Royal, president of the Faith and Reason Institute, and Austin Ruse, president of the UN watchdog group CFAM, are here to take a look at the United Nations Vatican broadside and more. The World Over Live continues in a moment. Mark Burnett and Roma Downey are straight ahead. Stay with us.
Now, once again, Raymond Arroyo.
Welcome back to the World Over Live. The United Nations Committee on the Rights of the Child released a statement this week, a report critical of the Holy See's response to the global sex abuse crisis, but they didn't stop there. They went on to urge changes to church teaching on certain issues. How far over the line has the UN gone? Here to tell us, I'm joined by the president of the Faith and Reason Institute and editor-in-chief of thecatholicthing.org, Robert Royal, as well as the president of the Catholic Family and Human Rights Institute, better known as CFAM, Austin Ruse. Gentlemen, thank you both for being here. Now, I want to start with why now? Why take this opportunity to comment on not only the church's approach to the sex abuse crisis, but then this kind of ad hominem attack on every major teaching of the Catholic Church? Austin.
The UN and its various human rights treaty monitoring bodies take every opportunity to advance an international right to abortion, to advance sexual orientation and gender identity as a new category of non-discrimination, to promote contraception and the whole panoply of UN-style family planning. So this is not unusual. What's unusual is that the Holy See was in the dock. The Holy See ratified this document in 1990, and this is only the second time that they've issued a report.
Well, and this begs the question, why did the Holy See sign on to these things? The United States, though Bill Clinton signed on to this, the Senate did not ratify it. Other countries have just not done it because it's an oppressive sort of regime once you become party to this. Why is the Holy See involved in this?
Well, I think that if you're familiar with the way European diplomats think about this is one of those nice things that you do. And if you go to the actual document, you see that the document talks about protecting life before birth as well as after birth.
This is in the preamble.
This is in the preamble to it. But there's a very odd thing that's begun, that you use these documents as a starting point. And then you go on to this new international set of rights and structures of one thing preceding another. So religious liberty and cultural differences, which are spoken of a lot in almost all UN documents, they're there in black and white, but they're not there in fact. So this gives you a chance to go out to the largest religious group that is a resistor to that new international order.
I want to play bites for you. I don't think either of you have heard these. This is Kirsten Sandberg. She is the chairperson
of the UN Human Rights Committee on the Rights of the Child. Here was a summary of the findings.
The main finding of the committee was that the Holy See has adopted policies and practices which have led to the continuation of the abuse by and the impunity of the perpetrators. The Holy See has consistently placed the preservation of the reputation of the Church and the protection of the perpetrators above children's best interests.
Austin Ruse, your reaction.
First of all, her voice is, you know, very dramatic, you know. But on the content of what she's talking about, the Holy See ratified this document with the written understanding that they were ratifying it as the Vatican City State. Yet this committee decided that they were going to determine that the Catholic Church all over the world is in the dock, and that the Vatican is responsible for every Catholic everywhere. Uh-huh. So they went beyond, just like on all the other things, they went beyond their own purview, and the Holy See made it clear when they were grilled in January that if you are concerned about something that happened in Ireland, you've got to talk to the Irish and not us.
Yeah, there is a broadening of scope here. How binding is a document like this, Robert Royal?
Well, when you sign
onto a report.
When you sign onto a treaty, you've signed onto a treaty. But as I said, the way that these documents are written, they're kind of a grab bag. There are bits and pieces of things that you know everyone is going to like or dislike, and they're there to create a consensus of a certain kind. When the Universal Declaration of Human Rights was passed, it was actually written largely by Jacques Maritain, one of the great Catholic philosophers in the 20th century. He said that everyone agrees to these principles just as long as you don't ask them why. And what we've started to see, first of all, I believe that document could never be passed right now because it is sort of an older document looking at religious liberty, cultural rights, parents, families, that sort of thing. Right. We've moved on to something else here. And it's not a surprise to me at all, I'm sure it's not for Austin either, that a committee like this, these committees are very rogue. They're not a very official, they've got no police power.
Yeah.
So they say a lot of things that people would like them to say.
But they really leaped from a critique of the handling of sex abuse to this. Roll it.
Holy See's past statements and declarations on homosexuality have contributed to the social stigmatization of and violence against lesbian, gay, bisexual, and transgender adolescents and children raised by the same sex couples.
So again, this is part of the protection of children and the rights of children.
The document itself, the treaty that they're supposed to monitor, doesn't mention this topic at all. They have jumped the shark, if you don't mind me saying
with
that.
Apologies to Henry Winkler.
Indeed. The document is silent on homosexuality. It's silent on abortion. It's silent on adolescents having sex with condoms. This committee has no right to expand the scope of the treaty and then make the Holy See answer questions based on this reinterpretation. They cannot do that.
And they went on to talk about the Church's teaching on contraception. We'll play that. Robert Royal, I want your reaction.
We also like to mention the negative consequences of the Holy See's position and practices of denying adolescents access to contraceptives, as well as to sexual and reproductive health and information.
Where is this leading? And do you think the Vatican's embarrassed to have signed this document in the first place? Do they regret it?
Well, I don't know. Who in the Vatican is now going to feel responsible? This happened 24 years ago, or however long it's been. In fact, the tragedy here is that this committee could have done some things that were useful by telling the Church that it needs to do even more than it has done. And we know that there are places like here in the United States where there's absolute zero tolerance, and you can't ask for any more. In fact, it may even be a little unchristian the way we apply this absolute zero tolerance of any sort of abuse of children. But to leave that and to go on to these other things, which are still highly controversial, and not only in this country but globally, these are not globally popular position. So for them to go from here to talking about condoms, to talking about homosexuality, to talking about abortion, they've actually missed an opportunity to do something that was part of their real mission for the sake of making this large ideological statement that has really come back to haunt them.
Very quickly, two quick issues I want to get to. Cardinal Stanislaw Zhivich, the longtime personal secretary of John Paul II, is caught in something of a media controversy. I don't know if it's a real controversy this week. John Paul asked that his personal notes be burned. Cardinal Zhivich kept many of them and has now published them, saying these are spiritual notes that should be preserved. Your thoughts?
Well, I think we have to see what's in there. If he used an editorial process by which he really did just leave sort of the spiritual. We hear a lot that many of these notes are the Pope asking himself, am I worthy to carry on as the leader? I mean, these are nice things to know.
It's personal, spiritual, the spiritual journey. Yeah, I don't think we'll see any side notes about Cardinal X or, Father so-and-so came in and he was really a bad guy.
So, I mean, you could argue this either way, but I'm glad we've got them.
Okay. Austin?
I hope some of that stuff is in there.
You and I both, but it's not going to be. I think Cardinal Zhivich probably burned those, and he said he did dispose with the more personal things that just aren't appropriate for public view. But this is the spiritual testament of the man. Final question, very quickly. There is talk that Pope Francis might be opening a door to married or divorced and remarried Catholics receiving the sacraments. Where do you think this really is?
It's hard to say because Cardinal Maradiaga of Guatemala, who's very close with the Pope, has spoken against Cardinal Mueller of the Congregation for the Doctrine of the Faith, who's been rather strict about the older view of the indissolubility of marriage. Mm-hmm. My worry is not so much where it is, but where it may go, because as we see with this UN commission, once these things begin to be opened up in this cultural climate in which we find ourselves, even within the church, I don't know that there's any stopping point short of something quite radical or something quite confusing. So it's worrisome.
But even Pope Benedict said this was a question open to some study, and it should be studied and looked at. There are an awful lot of people suffering, some who were, in an abusive marriage or something, they remarried, and now they find themselves caught in a long annulment process.
Well, it's even worse than that. One of my heroes, Monsignor Clark up in New York, said that half of the marriages are annullable because the bride went out the night before with her girlfriends and said, well, if it doesn't work out, I can always get a divorce. Mm. And that's material for an annulment. And I think this is also extremely common. You get married and you have no intention of having children. Mm. So many of the marriages today are annullable that it is kind of frightening. It is kind of frightening what may happen if they do something like this.
No, we'll keep our eyes on it. Austin Ruse, Robert Royal, thank you all for being here. You can read Robert Royal's columns by visiting the Catholic Thing website at thecatholicthing.org. And Austin is always at CFAM. He monitors many of the policies being advanced and promoted at the United Nations, and he now has a special status, which entitles him access to the UN, which he didn't quite have before. He's at CFAM, or C-FAM.org. Now, before we go, my next guests produced last year's massive hit miniseries, The Bible, on the History Channel. How massive? Over 100 million people saw that production. Now they're set to bring the life of Christ back to the big screen. On February 28th, their new film, Son of God, hits theaters. I spoke with them at the National Shrine in Washington this week before a screening of the movie. Here are producers of The Son of God, reality wonder kind, Mark Burnett, and actress Roma Downey. Take a look. Tell me how this movie, Son of God, is different from the miniseries.
The movie is a beautiful, beautiful journey through the Gospels. It just tells the story of Jesus' life. Jesus hasn't been on the big screen for 10 years. The movie opens at the Nativity, goes through his life, the miracles, the mission, his death, the resurrection, and through to the ascension. And it's a two-hour standalone experience. You don't see the movie as much as you feel the movie.
Now, tell me, Diogo, the actor you cast as Jesus, where did you find him?
He really came as the answer to a prayer. We were getting very close to filming and still had not found the correct actor to portray Jesus Christ. And Roma sent out an incredible, wide prayer request. And through a series of events that can only have been an answer to a prayer, we met Diogo Morgado. And Roma, on the moment she saw him walking up our garden path, said, that man is going to portray Jesus
And that was it? You didn't even have to read them?
No, we read them, of course, and we met with him, and we sat for hours talking to him. He knew it was going to be the most serious and important role he ever played. And he gives such a nuanced performance in the central role.
I want to give people a little sense of this performance. This is a scene from the feeding of the 5,000. Take a look.
They've come a long way. They're hungry.
Give them food.
But how? We have nothing. Just a few fish and some bread. Bring them to me. Thank you, Father, for what you bring us.
Our Father in heaven feeds the birds of the air. How much more will he give to you? Put God first and everything else will follow. If you hunger for righteousness, you will be filled through me.
Tell me about shooting that scene. It is such a powerful moment in this movie.
Oh, yeah, and the entry point into that scene, I love the moment where he's on the boat and those little children run by and he waves to the kids. Throughout the movie, you see the humanity of Jesus showing up, particularly how he is in the scenes with children. We filmed that scene on a very windy day. We had to gather hundreds, and then through special effects, we had to create the enormity.
You multiplied as well.
We did. We multiplied. We created 5,000 people there. But I think, you know, we have recreated miracles on the screen using special effects. Mm-hmm. But the miracle that was created there was in the simplicity of him just holding the basket up into the sunlight, and you see the light coming through it. And you know, the generosity of God to feed the people. Mm.
Mark, tell me, what was it like? When did you first learn that your wife was going to be playing the Virgin Mary?
You know, Roma went over to Morocco with her producer's hat firmly on her head. And it wasn't until we had cast the young Mary at the time of Nativity, and we just knew we hadn't found the right actress to play Mary at the time of the crucifixion. And I said to Roma, I think we've been missing it all along. It really should be you. And Roma said she would pray about it. And next day she said, you know, I think you're right. And obviously it was the most important role of your career.
It was such a privilege to step into the role. I have loved Mary and I have loved her son my whole life, and it was such an honor to step into the role. And those scenes filmed at the foot of the cross were amongst the most profoundly moving scenes, because I have never fully considered what it must have been to be Jesus' mother, because we know she was the mother of the Son of God, but she was also the mother of a son. And you know, to have to be there to see him die in such a way. My son.
Don't be afraid. Everything is possible with God.
Move forward!
Tell me what the reaction has been. You're here at the National Basilica.
Which we have to acknowledge, by the way.
Yes.
Wow.
This is quite a backdrop.
Which is my first time here. Roma came back from DC, I think, a couple of months ago with some photographs and said, I cannot believe the church I have just been in. He said, Mark, it's just like the greatest churches ever in Europe and the Middle East, and of course, I'm here. It's absolutely beautiful.
Yeah. Spectacular.
We're so, so happy to be here at the invitation of Monsignor Rossi to show some clips of Son of God to a gathered group here in preparation for the launch of the film. And it's the most spectacular I was awestruck when I first came in here. I heard Mass said here by Cardinal Wuerl, and profoundly moving to be here.
Now, you all have been touring not only the country, parts of the world. In Canada, you're here, you're everywhere, promoting the film. Why are you so tirelessly crisscrossing the country? And is Hollywood getting the message that there's an audience here that perhaps they weren't aware of initially?
Well, for us, the film is not a job as much as it's our passion. You know, I've been a Catholic my whole life, and there's no greater story, no more important story than the story of our Savior. It's the greatest love story that ever was. And so we have been traveling tirelessly just to let people know it's on. We're excited that 20th Century Fox are distributing the movie, but we don't have a marketing budget to compare with the big movies that are coming out. So it needs Mark and I to be out here making some noise, trying to let people know that the film is coming. You know, our Pope often has referred to a new evangelization, that we have to reach people where they're at. We know that young people are going to movies, young people aren't reading as much as they used to, and that here's a chance to bring the story right to them. And we know that when they see the story, hearts will be open, and when hearts are open, grace can move in.
Oh, holy night, the stars are brightly shining.
Mark Burnett and Roma Downey, Son of God, opens in theaters nationwide on February 28th. Visit sonofgodmovie.com for more details. And be sure to tune into The World Over on February 27th for my extended sit-down interview with Mark and Roma from their home in Southern California. We'll have a great time. Well, that is all the time we have for now. Until next week, the show continues on Facebook and Twitter. Like me on Facebook, follow me on Twitter. The links are on my website. And if you sign up for my free e-blast, I will send you exclusive content and the latest news. Go to the center of the webpage, RaymondArroyo.com. You can also catch the show 24/7 on EWTN's YouTube channel. I also post the show on my Facebook and Twitter pages, and you can get our podcast by visiting the EWTN website. Just look for the podcast button in the directory at the bottom of the page. See, there's no excuse for missing us. In the meantime, we'll be scouting the world over for all that is seen and unseen. On behalf of the staff and crew of EWTN News, thanks for watching. I'm Raymond Arroyo from Washington, D.C. See you next time. Bye now.